Wé Akip Jilidak. Hello and welcome to the Rathbeeson Community Center for game number 11 of the 2023 Coltech Nova Scotia Under 15 Major Hockey League Championship Tournament. This game will have the 1-1 Halifax Wolverines taking on the 0-3 Bedford Bandits. And now we'll send things downstairs for some pregame introductions. Before we get things going here, we take a moment to acknowledge that the Rathbeeson Community Center, the town of Truro, and the entire region covered by the Nova Scotia Under 15 Major Hockey League all lie within the ancestral unceded territory of Mi'kma'ki. We mentioned that the Wolverines come in with a record of 1-1. They opened up the tournament yesterday with a loss 4-3 to the Cougars. They bounced back with a 4-0 victory earlier today against the Novas. Starting goaltender for the Wolverines will be Dylan Benocio. And if I mispronounce that, I do apologize. Benocio making his first appearance in this tournament. For the Bedford Bandits, their record 0-3. They lost 10-1 to the Gulls, 6-2 to Truro, 5-2 to the Storm. Their starting goaltender is Jared Sorhindo. He played one game so far in this tournament, and that was the loss against the Truro Bearcats. So he comes in with a record of 0-1, a 5.07 goals against average, and an .800 save percentage. As we are underway here at the Rathbeeson Community Center, the Community Credit Union Arena, and the Wolverines ice the puck with 20 seconds gone. And it should be pointed out for the Bandits, they are still mathematically alive. If they can win this game, they'll finish the round-robin portion with a 1-3 record. They would need a lot of help. They would need a bunch of things to go their way tomorrow in order to qualify for the semifinals, but it is still mathematically possible, but it needs to start with a victory here in this game. They are 0-3 so far this weekend. They need to get a win, and then, like I said, they need to get some help to try and qualify in that fourth spot in the round robin. Elang right now with the puck. He'll play it back up the near side wall. Johnson sets it up there for Hodder. Hodder gets it in across the blue line as this battle of the basin is underway. Bedford against Halifax. Elang with the puck. He'll play it back to the line to McGilvery. McGilvery trying to get away from Shearer. Gets it down below the net for Elang. He tries to set it up for Hodder, but that ends up getting intercepted and launched down the ice. Or Hindo will leave it there for McGilvery. McGilvery plays it to Henry. Henry's cross-ice pass. Branton got a stick on it, but it still ends up getting to McQueen. Now Brocklehurst brings it in, but does so offside with 1:24 gone in the first period. Just to give you an idea of the help that the Bedford Bandits need. If they win this game, they would go to 1-3. The Wolverines would fall to 1-2. They would need, well, the result of the Gulls and the Novas wouldn't necessarily impact on the chances of the Bandits, but they would need New Scotland Storm to beat the Wolverines, and they would need the Toro Bearcats to beat the Toronto Jim Cougars. That would give Bedford, Halifax, and the Cougars all records of 1-3. Possibly the Novas a record of 1-3 as well if they beat the Gulls. If not, then it would be three teams tied at 1-3. And then we get into very complicated tiebreaker scenarios, but the Bandits would have a chance. And that has to be the message for the Bedford Bandits right now, is you still do have a chance, but you need to start by winning this game against the Halifax Wolverines. If you don't get this victory, obviously finishing 0-4 in the round robin, not the way they would want their season to come to an end. But if they can take care of their own business here, get a little bit of help tomorrow, maybe, just possibly, they could still make it into the semifinals, but they need some tiebreakers to go their way. Green has the puck behind his own net, throws it, and it ends up getting to Kidd. Kidd tries to go cross ice with that pass. Bottomley got a stick on it, but the Bandits still with possession. Now Kidd will play it deep into the Halifax zone. Comes off the end boards around the far side. Simonson able to play it ahead. That goes off the stick of Sullivan. There's a shot by Conlon. Now Gibbs sends it down low, goes all the way around to the far side. Trying to get it out in front there was Conlon, but that gets broken up. And now Bottomley will get the pass ahead for Sullivan. Sullivan trying to cut to the outside against Link. Offside was called, so the Wolverines have to back out and touch up. Now we'll get the puck back down into the Bedford zone. Link will play it across to the near side. Gibbs uses the boards but can't get the puck past Lovett. And it's sent back in deep. Link will get to it there. Benigno tries to get it set up for Lovett, but that pass is intercepted. And now Alex Elang coming the other way. He'll send it down into the corner, go chasing after it himself. Plays it off the wall to Hodder. Hodder gives it right back to Elang. Elang back for Hodder in front of the net, but he can't get a shot away as Swift was there along with Gerard to help break that up. Now Shearer bringing the puck up the other way. He'll play it to Gerard. Gerard for Lovett. Lovett let it go through to Shearer. Shearer's shot goes up into the end boards, or end glass, I should say. Now Hodder's pass out of the reach of Johnson. Puck comes out to Gerard in neutral ice. Johnson gets right on top of Gerard right away. Lovett has to come back and help out. Play it back to Swift. He'll get it ahead for Shearer, and Shearer will send it down into the Bandit zone, but that's going to be an icing against the Halifax Wolverines with 4:12 gone here in the first period. This game number 7 on the day today. As we mentioned, the Bits earlier today lost to the Storm. The Wolverines earlier today defeated the Novas. And a difference of a little bit of time in those games. Here's Uzuchukwu with a shot, and he'll fire that one just wide. The Bandits played in the 2 o'clock game this afternoon, while the Wolverines played at 12 o'clock. Whether that extra 2 hours of difference makes a difference, we'll wait and see. Just for reference, though, every team playing twice today, and the teams that had more rest, even if it was only by a span of 2 hours, have gone actually, the teams with more rest have only gone 1-3 so far in games today. So, not an advantage, really, to have the extra bit of rest. Puck goes way up high into the air, comes down, bouncing in front of Shearer, but Brocklehurst is the one who ends up getting the puck. McQueen now able to play it over, gets a pass back again from O'Leary. Puck gets to the line and just out as Link tried to keep it onside. Now McQueen sends it back in across the line as they play ping pong here. Back and forth across the blue line. It finally ends up down in the Bedford zone. And Gibbs plays it ahead. Brocklehurst couldn't take that pass, and Turgeon will pick it up in his own end. Gets it to the line. Glove down there by Gibbs. He'll skate along the wall. Gets a shot away, and the save made there by Benoscio. I will try and get that right, and if somebody can send me a phonetics guide on how to say his name correctly, I do not want to offend. Please send me that at through Twitter, at Petter, PETTER_sports. I think it should be Benoscio, but I am not sure. Again, please send that to me through Twitter, at Petter, PETTER_sports, or you can reach me through Facebook. Go to Facebook.com and then search for Petter Sports and Streaming and send me a message that way, and I would be grateful. With the way the schedule works, I haven't had time to get down to the dressing rooms and check with coaches on pronunciations and whatnot. Having games going every 2 hours, there isn't a whole lot of turnaround time in between to check pronunciations. Conlon with a shot that goes off Girard's leg. Swift gets the puck, and he sends it down the ice. Not hard enough for an icing as Henry and Sullivan go in after it. Sullivan wins that battle for it, but there was nobody up there to help him. Sullivan able to get it to the net himself, but it's finally tied up along the net there as McGilfrey ends up with the stick of his goaltender Jared Serhindo in his skate. And now we'll get a face-off to Sorhindo's right. Proctor tried to come in and get a shot away, but the puck was knocked off of his stick. Now Johnson going the other way. His pass for Alain doesn't quite connect. Coming back on the back check, Hodder able to play it over to Breen. And Breen will work his way out to center ice. Gains the red line, dumps the puck in. Benoscio settles it there for Bent. Played around to Truin. He'll get it ahead to Proctor. Proctor's pass just off target. Now Breen with it at his own line. He'll play it ahead for Hodder. Gives to Alain. Alex Alain with a shot. That goes just wide. Now Truin. He'll work the puck out to center. It hops past Normore. Proctor coming in, trying to take advantage. Flip the puck over to the near side wall. Breen able to get it. Now Benigno steals it from Breen. Gets a shot away. And Sorhindo with the blocker save. Benigno now. He fires. And Sorhindo another save as Benigno is trying to go short side. And he'll hang on for a faceoff. 7:17 left to go, rather. Here in period number one. For the Bandits, this is their final game of the incomplete round robin, as I call it. Each team playing four games. There are seven teams here, so it's not a full round robin. Benotio. Thank you very much, Ben Rittenberg, for sending me that. Benotio. Okay, thank you very much. So Dylan Benotio, I will work on that. Brocklehurst takes a big hit there. Now puck goes to the far wall. Link fans on his first attempt to get it ahead, does get it up to Brocklehurst. It ends up on the stick of Simonson. He plays it over to the near side for Bent. Bent across for Shearer. Shearer has it knocked off his stick by Link. Brocklehurst able to get the puck. He'll get it to McQueen. McQueen coming in, backhand shot, and that goes wide of the net. Now Truen will send it behind the net to Bent. Bent's pass up for Shearer, just out of his reach, and that will result in an icing call against the Halifax Wolverines with 6:15 remaining here in period number one. And some lumber left on the ice there. That was Shearer's stick. We'll get the faceoff. One by Conlin, back to McGilvery. He'll skate it down into the corner. Reverses his direction, now plays it back to the line for Carver. Carver sends it back down the boards. It goes off of McGilvery and ends up on the stick of MJ Bottomley. Bottomley works his way in. His shot blocked by Henry. Now battle below the goal line. Played ahead to Kidd. Kidd will get it forward for Conlin. Conlin's pass intended for Carver. That gets broken up, and now it's dumped down deep into the Halifax zone. Truen with the puck. Plays it over to Sullivan. Sullivan ahead for Bottomley. And Bottomley will bring it in across the blue line. His pass for Nickel, broken up by Breen. And Kidd will go the other way with it. Gets it across to Normore, who got it up to Breen. Now Breen will drop it to Kidd for Carver. Carver couldn't get a shot away. Puck comes to Normore. His shot gets through. Benodio the save. Kidd with the second chance shot, but that doesn't quite get all the way through. Now Breen at the line, plays it down into the corner. Conlin takes a bump from Bent. Bent trying to kick the puck free. He'll get it onto his stick, play it around to the far wall. Normore throws it at the net. Benodio will cover up and hang on for a faceoff. 4:57 left to go here in the first period. As the faceoff will be in the Halifax zone to the left of the netminder. A lane in to take the draw against Branton. Proctor ends up with the puck, gets it as far as the line link, held it in momentarily, but inertia bringing the puck back out to center. Now Hodder's pass, broken up by Proctor. Hodder ends up getting it back again, brings it back in across the line, knocked off his stick by Swift. Proctor not able to get by his man, but here comes Uzuchukwu. He'll fire a shot, that goes just wide to the far post side against Sorhindo. Now a pass intercepted by Branton. He couldn't get a shot away though, as Gibbs was there to knock it away from Branton. Over for Elaine, back to Gibbs, but Gibbs came in just a step early. So we'll get an offside call against the Bedford Bandits with 4:19 left to go here in the opening period. As Brocklehurst, the captain for the Bandits, takes the draw against one of the assistant captains, that being Ian Lovett of the Halifax Wolverines. Now Bent with the puck down below his own goal line, ends up losing his stick. He's able to kick the puck over to Truen. Truen will get it around the boards. McGilvery holds it in. Bent able to pick his stick back up as he goes back into the corner. Puck played off the glass by Truen. It ends up hitting one of the players in the Halifax bench, so we'll get a stoppage with 3:56 remaining in the first. We mentioned the Wolverines have one more game left tomorrow. They'll be taking on the New Scotland Storm. Let's take a quick look at the standings. The Storm right now tied for first with the Truro Bearcats. Both of these teams 3-0 so far on the tournament. In third place, it is the Gulls with a record of 2-1. The John L. Jim Cougars, in fourth place it is the Halifax Wolverines at 1-1. The Cougars are fifth with a record of 1-2. And tied for sixth and seventh, the Bedford Bandits and the Novas, both at 0-3 right now. But like I said, 1-3 could still potentially get into a semifinal, depending on how everything plays out through tonight's game and the three games tomorrow. Gulls versus Novas, New Scotland Storm versus Wolverines, and John L. Jim Cougars versus Truro Bearcats at 8, 10, and noon respectively. And depending on how all those games play out and what kind of tiebreakers we end up having to work with, we will know the matchups for the 5 o'clock and 7:30 semifinals to determine who will be playing for gold Sunday at 1 and who will be playing for bronze Sunday at 10 a.m. as we pass the midway point of this tournament for the total number of games played. O'Leary with the centering pass. That's broken up by Bent, and Bent will come out with it. Bent gets around a couple of players, still heading towards the net. Ends up getting spun around, and his stick caught the side of the head of Surhindo. Fortunately for Jared Surhindo, that mask that he's got on, plenty of protection. Puck now cleared down the ice, and that will miss the net by enough that it is an icing with 2:33 remaining. Jared Surhindo, there you see, getting a well-deserved drink of water after taking that bonk on the bean. And no ill will intended, certainly, by Cole Bent as he was heading towards the net, got spun around, and his stick just sort of went with the centrifugal force. Or with the central pedal force. Mr. Zanin, if you're watching, my physics teacher from when I was in high school, I'm sorry I don't remember the difference between centrifugal and centripetal force. It's been a while since I've had to use that stuff. Here's Branton working his way in. Puck comes up the wall to Proctor. He'll fire a shot, and that goes just up over the crossbar into the end glass. Now Branton takes it down into the corner. Puck ends up with Kidd. He ends up losing control of it. Uzuchukwu can't get it to stay on his stick. And finally, Simonsen plays it back down into the zone. Here's Proctor. He's got Uzuchukwu with him. Takes the shot. And the save made off the blocker of Jared Surhindo. Now Proctor will send it down into the corner near side. Uzuchukwu able to get onto the puck. Goes to play it back to the line, but the Halifax Wolverines were in the process of getting their defenders changed, and so there was nobody there to receive that pass. Lovett with it now, just inside his own blue line, gets it out to center, loses control of it there, and McLean will go the other way. He gives it to his line mate out there. That was Kidd, who got the puck deep into the Halifax zone as we're down to the final minute of period number one. McGilvery, as we're going to get a penalty here against Halifax. Swift ended up taking Johnson into the boards. And our officials are going to talk it over here, whether they're going to call that boarding or checking from behind. And that will have an impact on this game, as they are going to call it check from behind. So Swift is done for the night. Dawson Swift taking a check from behind penalty, and that will carry with it a game misconduct. So with 49.8 seconds left to go in the first period, the Halifax Wolverines will lose one of their key defensemen, and the Bedford Bandits will get their first power play of the game. And going over to serve the penalty will be Charlie Benigno. Bandits on their first power play of the night. They are 2-for-13 so far in the tournament with the man advantage. But the Halifax Wolverines, on the flip side, on the penalty kill, have been perfect to this point. They are 7-for-7 killing penalties. Green with the puck in neutral ice. He'll play it over to Alain. Alain able to get it deep into the Halifax zone. Truin will pick it up. He'll fire it up the wards. Brocklehurst there to knock that down. Brocklehurst comes in. His shot blocked by Truin. Not able to clear the zone was Nickel. Now Gibbs back with it at the line. He'll play it over to the far side. Green fans on a shot attempt, or a pass attempt rather, and that will allow Nickel to get the puck out to center ice. McQueen back into his own zone, and that will end the first period. Shots on goal in the first favor the Bedford Bandits by a margin of 6-5. No scoring in that opening 15 minutes, so we'll head into our quick break between the first and second period with the score even up at zeros. And while the teams have a quick chat, we'll let you know that the game sponsor for game number 11 is Basin Contracting Limited. And we can also let you know that the major sponsors for the tournament, the gold level sponsor, Coltech Windows and Entrance Systems, silver level sponsors, Andy's Tire Shop Limited, SBM Offshore, and Maritime Truss Limited. Bronze level sponsors, Motor Hub Automotive Group, Stanfield Limited, Dairy Queen, and Virtual McDougall. And the one downside of having been in this building for the last 13 hours and having to say the words Dairy Queen over and over and over again, you get a bit of a hankering for a blizzard after you say those words. Yeah, I arrived here just before 7 o'clock this morning. Have left this room a few times to get as far as either the washroom or the concession stand here. But that's about it. Other than that, I've sat in this room for almost 14 hours now. Here's Gibbs with the puck. Gets it across to Brocklehurst for McQueen. McQueen couldn't get the puck to sit on his stick to get a shot away. Now Breen with it from the faceoff dot, gets a shot. Benoglio with the save. The stick of, who was that? Branton ends up breaking as he partially blocked the shot. And the puck ends up going up out of play with 28 seconds left to go in the power play for the Bedford Bandits. And the puck did go either off of Benoglio or off of one of the Halifax defenders. Couldn't say for sure which. Either way, the faceoff does end up staying inside the Halifax zone into the final 30 seconds of the power play. McGilvery will play it around the boards. Comes up the wall on the near side. Conlon couldn't get his stick on it. Lovett does, and he fires it down the length of the ice. And Sir Hindo will set it up for McGilvery. McGilvery starting to work the puck ahead. Across the blue, across the red, and across the blue again as he then rings the puck around the boards. O'Leary has it get by him. Potter gets to the puck. He'll play it to McGilvery as we're back to 5-on-5. Across! And what a chance for O'Leary there. Didn't get quite as much on that as he wanted. Now here's a chance coming the other way for Benigno. Coming in! And Sir Hindo makes a huge save. Great save there by Jared Sir Hindo on Benigno coming in on the breakaway after Benigno served that penalty. They were able to set it up that when he came out of the penalty box, he was there to take the breakout pass. And Jared Sir Hindo came up with a huge save to keep this game knotted up at Goose Eggs. Simonson plays it around the boards for Proctor. It ends up going all the way to Normore. He'll send it back in deep. Simonson missed the first chance to move the puck. Now gets it ahead for Uzuchukwu. Out to center, Branton. But the Lions person says Proctor did not keep his skate on the blue paint of the line. And so we get an offside call against the Wolverines. And I understand that people may disagree with the call, but you know, you look at these officials, they're working hard, they're doing their best. No need to boo them. I understand being upset about the call, but come on. Turgeon plays it ahead. Breen holds it in at the line. Now down into the corner. Simonson working against O'Leary. McQueen comes in. He gets his stick on the puck, but now it ends up with O'Leary. He'll play it around. Breen will step in and take it down to the corner. Throws it to the front of the net. Brocklehurst couldn't get a shot away. Now the puck ends up with Proctor. He'll get it ahead for Uzuchukwu. Coming in, trying to get a step on Normore. He does. Comes in. And Sir Hindo, another nice save. Although Sir Hindo looked like he was a little bit awkward getting back onto his feet there. Now Brocklehurst coming the other way. Can't get a pass across to McLean. The puck goes into the end boards. Proctor will pick it up as it comes around to the near side. He'll get it out and down the ice. And that will be just enough for an icing against the Halifax Wolverines here with 2:49 gone in the second period. And this Bedford Bandits team, they have not played bad hockey all weekend. They've had some bounces not go their way, certainly. But they are, I mean, to get to this tournament, you've got to have done a few things right throughout the course of the season, and they certainly have. Conlon ends up bringing the puck in, but not able to get out of the zone in time was Carver over at the far side, and I don't think that Conlon saw that Carver was still in the zone. Now the two number 19s, Conlon and Lovett, take the draw directly below our broadcast position here up in the high reaches of the Rathiesling Community Center, the Community Credit Union Arena. Puck played to the line and held in at the line by McLean. He gets it back down the boards for Conlon. Now into the middle of the ice and able to clear it away is Girard. Down the ice it goes, not hard enough for an icing, as Shearer is able to get there and get to the puck before it reaches the end line. Now Shearer will take it out from the corner, back to the line for Bent. Bent with the shot. Lovett was looking for a deflection, didn't quite redirect it onto the target. Now Lovett with it behind the net, trying to get away from Henry. Takes it to the corner. Beignol with the shot. And I believe that was blocked in front by McGilvery. Now Bent gets it back ahead for Sullivan. Lovett tries to play it forward. McGilvery knocks that down, and he'll send it down into the Halifax zone. It gets past Benotio. Now Sullivan gets it to Nickel. Nickel just keeping his back foot onside. Tried to get it over for Beninho, but Beninho was tied up just enough by Hodder to deny a shot. Now Hodder brings the puck out to center. Hodder working against Truin. Truin able to knock the puck off his stick. Alain following up gets the shot away, and that deflects way up into the netting as Benotio steers that away. And we'll get a stoppage with 10:39 left to go here in the second period. Face-off won by Nickel over to Simonson. Simonson flips the puck out to center ice. Link back to get it just at his own blue line. Being watched by Bottomley, he'll play it over for Gibbs. Gibbs now gets it up to Hodder. Hodder has that puck bounce off his stick, but stays on the puck and is able to get it back. Now Hodder able to bring it into the Halifax zone. Hodder back on it again. Plays it back to the line for Gibbs. Gibbs couldn't get the puck, but Link held it onside. Now Bottomley will get it out to center. And Gibbs back on it. He'll play it over to the near side for Hodder. 5 minutes gone in the second period. Simonson able to pick up the puck in his own zone. Play it off the glass. It ends up hitting O'Leary on the bench. And so we'll get a stoppage with 9:55 to go here in the second period. This is the 11th game that we've had in the last 2 days here, starting at 12 noon yesterday. And got to give a huge shout out to the ice crew here at the Rathiesling Community Center, as they have kept this ice in great shape so far here this weekend. And not just the 18 games that we're going to have here in this tournament this weekend, there's kind of a big game coming up on Sunday night after this tournament ends as well, as it'll be game number one of the Maritime Hockey League opening round of the playoffs. There's a chance for Brocklehurst. The Truro Bearcats host the Valley Wildcats in the cat fight series. Proctor coming in, gets the shot away, but he puts it over the crossbar and into the end glass. I'm sure fans of both Truro and Valley would love me calling it the cat fight series. McQueen now tried to make a pass. That is one of the Eastlink South Division semifinal series in the Maritime Hockey League. Game one of the other Eastlink South Division series going tonight in Yarmouth, as Benotio able to cover up the puck. Now he gets some pushing and shoving right at the top of the crease. No penalties will come of this, but the referee letting it be known that players are to stay at their bench until situations like that cool down before they try to come on for a change. 8:42 to go here in the second period. And I'm pretty sure that out of the 11 games we've had so far, this is the longest we've gone before reaching our first goal of the game. I'm just going to quickly go through my sheets and double check that. I'm 99.9% positive on that. As yeah, this is just the second game to go into the second period without a goal. The other one was the one that we just had finished just before this one, which was the Bearcats and the Novas. And the first goal in that game came 5 minutes and 34 seconds into the second. We're here now almost 7 minutes into the second period. So this is the longest we've gone scoreless in any game so far in the tournament. And a big part of that obviously has been, and now we're going to get another penalty as Lovett ends up taking down a Bedford player right in front of the Halifax bench. And Lovett is going to go off for boarding. Yes, boarding is the call. So the Bandits will get their second power play of the game here with 7:49 to go in the second period. So the Bandits were not able to score with their first power play. Get their second chance here to try and open the scoring in the game. Gibbs gets it across to Brocklehurst. Brocklehurst steps in, fires a shot, and he scores! Max Brocklehurst gets the first goal of the game for the Bedford Bandits as he scores on the power play. And for Brocklehurst, that is, let me just double check here quickly, I believe his third goal of the tournament? Yes, it is. Third goal and sixth point to lead his team in both of those categories. And his team's third power play goal out of the six. He's actually had a point on every goal that his team has scored so far in this tournament, as he now has 3 goals and 3 assists, and his team has scored 6 times. So not hard to determine the player who's been the big difference for them. Schaefer Gibbs and Ryder McQueen get the assists on that goal. Gibbs, that's his second assist of the tournament. McQueen, that's his second assist and third point. There's a chance for Proctor. He puts it just wide. Now coming out with the puck, here is Alain, but coming in just a hair ahead of him was Hodder. James Hodder just a step too early. And so we'll get an offside call. The Bedford Bandits' last power play lasted just 8 seconds before that goal. And again, they're now 3-for-15 on the power play after being 1-for-2 so far this evening. Puck is dumped down into the Halifax zone, comes to the line. Normore with a shot, that goes wide. Truwin going after it in the far corner, working against Hodder. Truwin able to kick it up to Uzuchukwu. He'll get it ahead for Branton. And Branton will work his way up through center into the Bedford zone. Try to get a shot away, that ends up going wide. But part of the reason it went wide is because Branton was booked or held. Up the referee signaled holding. Double check. Or he was slashed, actually, is what the call is. So the Halifax Wolverines will get their first power play of the night on this slashing penalty taken by Ethan Normore, coming with 6:47 left to go in the second period. The Wolverines so far 2-for-13, excuse me, on the power play so far this weekend. The same numbers, actually, that the Bandits were coming into tonight's game. Bandits on the penalty kill, 5 of 7 have been successfully killed off. So So that's 71.4%. 2 of 13 on the power play. The math real quickly, that is, let's see, 15, about 15.4% on the power play. See, I can do math. I'm even a math teacher. 1:38 left to go, and the penalty taken by Ethan Normore. Yeah, I'm getting a little loopy here, folks, but that's all right. Don't worry. Just wait till we get to around this time tomorrow night. Don't worry, I'll get a nap between the end of the round robin and the semifinal games, though. Puck goes on to the side of the net. It's knocked off again. Now played over into the corner. McQueen picks up there. He'll get it out to center ice. Bent able to pick up there. He'll take it all the way back down into his own zone. Back up and take a look around. Now he'll start to work his way up the left wing side. Gains the red line. Dumps the puck in. It hops over the stick of Sorhindo. And now trying to go cross crease with that pass intended for Shearer, but it's knocked away from danger. DeBent gets to it at the line, plays it down the wall to Benigno. Right for Shearer in front. There's a chance for True, and he couldn't get a shot away. Lovett does, and Sorhindo makes the save, and the puck ends up going behind the net and then played out to center. Now here comes a two-on-one shorthanded for the Bandits. McLean coming in. He's got a man with him. Takes the shot, and Benovio able to make the save off of the blocker and keep it a 1-0 scoreline. Good chance there for the Bandits shorthanded. Now Breen brings the puck back into the Halifax zone. Tries to go cross ice with that pass. Benigno intercepts, and he'll work his way down the ice. Benigno tried to get a pass through for Lovett. That was knocked off the skate of McGilvery. Then a shot following up by Shearer. It was steered aside by Sorhindo, and the puck played down into the Halifax zone. Here come the Wolverines again. Branton has the puck get a little bit too far from him, and Sorhindo, as he tried to make the save, had the net knock free, and Branton was trying to argue that the whistle shouldn't have been blown, but the net clearly came off. I don't think Branton realized that. Branton was right that the puck was not smothered, but Branton not realizing that the net had come loose from its moorings, and that was why we had the whistle. With 5 seconds left in the Halifax power play, puck played right towards the net off of the draw as Uzuchukwu took the shot, but it was blocked before the way it got all the way to Sorhindo. As we are now back to 5-on-5, a little bit of you take it, I got it, as Gibbs gets to the puck. And it ends up in the Bedford bench as Turgeon went to play it off the boards. And so we'll get a stoppage with 4:33 left to go here in the second period. Faceoff will stay in the Halifax zone, as that was where it was shot from before it ended up in the Bandits bench. Link tries to go D-to-D with that pass, but Proctor gets a piece of it. Now Proctor able to feed it to Uzuchukwu. Uzuchukwu coming in, and the save made. Somebody's stick went flying as that shot was taken. I see now that it was Gibbs. I think he got his stick just into the shooting lane enough that it slowed up that puck and helped out Sorhindo. Now coming the other way. Here's a chance. Brocklehurst tries the wraparound, but able to make the save was Benotio. And then we get a little bit of a discussion afterwards. Oh, I realize the clock cam has gotten knocked away here. Let's see if we can find the right spot. There we go. 4:08 left to go in the second period. Not quite sure how the clock cam got bumped there. Bent. We'll play it over to Gerard. He gets it up the wall. Now it's turned over to Conlin. His shot. And Benotio able to dive on the puck before any rebound could be had by the Bandits. 3:57 left to go here in the second period. 1-0 the score in favor of the Bedford Bandits. The lone goal of the game coming off the stick of Max Brocklehurst, as he has now been involved in all 6 Bandits goals so far this weekend. 3 goals, 3 assists for the Bedford captain. Sullivan battling below the goal line. working against. That was, oh my gosh, Henry, sorry, brain go not work now. Sullivan sends the puck towards the net. Sir Hindo makes the save and hangs on for another faceoff. The English language is great when you know how to use it. Unfortunately for me, sometimes I completely forget. Love it. We'll line up for the faceoff there against Alain. Alain able to win the draw forward, but Simonson gets it, gets a shot away. The save was made. Benigno gets the rebound. Benigno, another shot. That save is also made. Now the puck gets to the line. Truen holds it in. Played it down for Benigno, but that pass hopped away from him. Now he gets it back, gets another shot away, and yet another save made by Sir Hindo. Now Lovett with a shot. As Jared Sir Hindo makes, what was that, five saves in the span of about 25, 30 seconds? As between the two goaltenders tonight, they have stopped 37 of 38 shots. And you can't put much more of the weight on one than the other, as they've each faced 19 so far here tonight. Some great goaltending by Benotio and Sir Hindo. Now here's McQueen taking the puck, gets it over to Brocklehurst, but Benigno on the back check, able to knock the puck away from him. Normore tries to center it. That gets knocked down by Simonson. And Simonson will play it around the boards. Shearer able to get it the rest of the way out to center. Brocklehurst picks up just inside his own blue line, turns to get away from Lovett, sends the puck off the boards and down the ice. Truen picks up just inside his own blue line. Now his pass across, broken up by Brocklehurst. Brocklehurst coming in. Can't get through the check of Simonson. And Simonson able to get it out to center. Shearer couldn't find it in his feet. Now it ends up with Benigno. He fires a shot and scores! Charlie Benigno able to take advantage of a loose puck. He pounced on it and got his second goal of the tournament, his fourth point, and ties up the game at a goal apiece. Oop, sorry, there we go, we'll put it on the right side, there we are. With 2:13 left to go here in the second period, Charlie Benigno ties up the game. Shearer gets the lone assist on that one. 12:47, the time of the goal for Benigno. Again, his second goal, fourth point of the tournament, assisted by Will Shearer, making it a 1-1 score. Uzuchukwu can't get the puck as he was met by Gibbs. Link now with it. He'll play it up to Gibbs. Gibbs gets it out to center. Turgeon dumps it right back in again. And Link will go pick it up behind his own net. Branton in on the forecheck. Link passes it to Alain. Alain gets it off the glass and out to center. It gets just past Bent, but Bent gets in the way of Potter, who is trying to come in and get on the puck, as Turgeon does come pick it up. Turgeon gets it to the line. McGilvery will send it back deep into the zone. Bent picks up below his own goal line, plays it to Uzuchukwu. Uzuchukwu gets it ahead to Branton. Branton tried to get it down the ice, but he put it right into the midsection of the linesperson there. Now we're into the final minute of period number two with the score tied at a goal apiece. Here's Henry with the puck now. He'll get it up to Alain. Alex Alain in across the blue line, across to the far side for McGilvery. McGilvery in front for McLean, and he scores! Bedford Bandits reclaim the lead as a nice redirection there by Fenwick McLean with 40.7 seconds left to go in the second period. McLean able to redirect the pass and beat Dylan Benotio
They bring the second goal, scored by number 10, Henry McCain, assisted by number 15, Paul Gilbert, and the number 27, Paul Carter, and 41 seconds.
McGilvery and Carver get the assists. So Fenwick McLean, his first goal, first point of the tournament, assisted by Owen McGilvery and Calvin Carver at 14:20 of the second period to put the Bedford Bandits back out in front. Now with 10.0 seconds left on the clock, we'll have a face-off inside the Halifax zone. And Elaine trying to set up his players where he wants them to be. But Lovett ends up winning the draw for Halifax. Played out to center. Breen goes to knock it back in. It gets into the feet of the linesman, and Lovett will not get time to get a shot away. And that will do it for period number two. Shots in the second period. The Bedford Bandits get 16 shots away for a two-period total of 22. Halifax Wolverines with 15 shots for a two-period total of 20. But after no scoring in the first period, we get three goals in the second, two by the Bandits, one by the Wolverines. And so after 30 minutes of play, it is Bedford Bandits 2, Halifax Wolverines 1. We're going to take a break. We'll come back, get ready for the third period in just a few minutes. You are watching the Coltech 2023 Nova Scotia Under 15 Major Hockey Championship Tournament here on Atlantic Hockey Online through AO Live, produced by Petter Sports and Streaming.
And they'll play one game where they won't take any minutes and penalties, and then they'll take 700.
Welcome back as we get ready for the third period of this game, the 21st period of hockey on the day. And let's see, the 33rd period of hockey for this tournament. Well, I mean, it's not that hard to figure out, you know, multiplying numbers by three. I mean, come on. Cut me some slack here. As we get ready for the start of the period, the Bedford Bandits carrying a 2-1 lead into the third. A chance to get a victory, and then they'll have to wait for tomorrow to see if they get the help that they need to possibly book a spot in the semifinals. As making his way over to the bench, the backup goaltender for this game, Tucker Potter, enjoying the music, singing along with it. Why not? And we're going to take a quick look as we see it is the captain's birthday for the Wolverines. Happy birthday to Angus Proctor. He's having a pretty good game out there. And Proctor starting this period on the bench, but I know he'll get plenty of ice time here in the third, especially with his team trailing by a goal as they are right now. Proctor, one of the offensive weapons for this Wolverines team, as Brocklehurst and Lovett will take the faceoff to start period number three, with the Wolverines trailing. Bandits win the draw. Brocklehurst with the puck. He scored one of the two goals for Bedford. As it's played down into the Halifax zone. Bent back to get it. He'll send it ahead to Shearer. Shearer and Benigno a little bit crossed up there. Meanwhile, away from the puck, we have Gibbs and Shearer end up bumping into each other. Incidental contact as neither of them were looking where they were going, and they just kind of collided and both ended up going down. Now the puck comes out to center ice again. McQueen will try to work his way around Bent. Bent able to force the turnover there. Now he'll get the puck ahead and send it in deep. Sorhindo gets to it there. Henry met immediately by Lovett. Kidd comes back to help out. He'll play it around to the far side for McGilvery. McGilvery returns it back to the near side for Henry. Henry nearly coughs it up, but Conlon comes back and helps him out. Now the puck comes to the line, held in by Branton. Branton to the middle of the ice, gets it to Proctor. Proctor coming in, and Sorhindo not allowing Proctor to get a birthday present there as he makes the save. Now Branton can't get the puck back into the zone. Bent will, and it goes down below the goal line. McGilvery plays it off the wall to get around the pressure of Proctor. It's played over the head of Uzuchukwu out to center. Bent now gets the pass ahead, and that ends up deflecting into the Bedford bench, and so we'll get another stoppage. 1:37 gone here in the third period. And we'll once again remind you tomorrow's schedule, 8 a.m., the Gulls take on the Novas. Gulls with a record of 2-1. Novas go into that game with a record of 0-3. The New Scotland Storm at 3-0 will take on these Halifax Wolverines at 10 a.m. And the Wolverines, will they be 2-1? Will they be 1-2? Or will they be 1-1-1 and we finally get our first tie of the tournament? Well, we're 18 minutes and 7 seconds away from determining what that will be. And then our last game of the round robin, the Jonel Jim Cougars, who right now are 1-2, will take on the 3-0 Truro Bearcats in the final game of the tournament. And depending on how the other two games of the morning play out, that game could have significant ramifications on how the semifinal matchups play out. There's Uzuchukwu with a shot steered away by Sorhindo. Now Proctor holds it in, and then Simonson holds it in at the line as well. Comes to the near boards. Uzuchukwu getting it down below the goal line. Proctor looking to get it out in front. It goes off the side of the net, and making the cover is Sorhindo. With 17:25 left to go here in the third period. Again, the Bandits are still alive in this tournament for a semifinal spot. They will need some help. First things first, they need to hang on to this lead for the last 17 minutes and 21 seconds. Here comes Sullivan with a shot, and Sorhindo able to make the save. Now McQueen gets the puck out to center. Bottomley able to steal it from him there. Brings it back in. Bottomley trying to get away from McQueen. Sends the puck towards the net. Sullivan was there for a partial screen, but it was still batted away. And now Girard in his own zone able to pick up the puck. Brocklehurst had lost his footing, but no penalty coming there. Now McQueen. Brings the puck back in. Brocklehurst gets it. He kicked it to where McQueen ended up being. Now it comes down towards the goal line. And Benotio able to make the save. And hang on. Getting another faceoff. 16:36 left to go here in the third. And again, after those three games, we'll wrap up the round robin portion of the tournament. Have a couple of hours while the tournament officials go through everything. As coming out of the net to play at Sorhindo, but Benigno was there. And that nearly turned disastrous for Bedford, but it ends up working out for them. Now turning and firing a shot is Shearer. That ends up hitting Henry. Shearer back on the puck. Now it comes to Truin near side. Truin goes far side with it, looking for Benigno, but Benigno couldn't quite get his stick on the puck. Now Shearer sends it to Lovett right behind the net. Over to Truin, there's a shot! And that ends up going all the way into the far corner. Simonson gets it down into the corner. Lovett plays it around to the near side. Shearer will get it back to the line. Truin, he gets it to Lovett in the high slot. He fires a shot, and that gets deflected up over the glass and out of play. And we'll get a stoppage with 15:44 left in the third period. Again, those semifinals tomorrow at 5 o'clock and then 7:30. And prior to the first semifinal, we will have the presentation of the tournament awards. And some difficult decisions, certainly for the committee that will be deciding those awards, as there have been some real standout performances by several players here so far this weekend. Green now gets the puck across. Carver swings and misses at that one. Now comes around to the near side. Kidd takes a bump from Uzuchukwu. And Branton will get the puck, and he'll work it out to center. Has it knocked off his stick by Normore. Then O'Leary, or Carver rather, has it knocked off his stick by Truin. And the puck down deep into the Bedford zone. Green across for Normore. Ethan Normore working through center. Tries to get a pass to Conlin. Uzuchukwu gets a stick in the way of that, but the puck ends up on the stick momentarily of Kidd. Now it's out and then back into the zone. Now Truen will carry it out of the Halifax end all the way down into the Bedford side. And then has it knocked off his stick by Link. Puck played back down to the corner. Link will get to it there. He'll take it back behind his net. Get it ahead for Carver. Carver's pass. Kidd gets his stick on it. It goes up into the glass and then leaves the zone and gets brought back in again by Nickel. And that will result in an offside against Halifax. 14:32 left to go here in the third period. 2-1 in favor of the Bedford Bandits over the Halifax Wolverines in our last game of the day here at the Rathbeeslink Community Center. Gibbs plays the puck across the far side, intended for Link. That pass a little bit out of his reach. And now getting to it is Sullivan for the Halifax Wolverines. He plays it out front. It comes all the way to the line for Turgeon. His shot gets through, and Sorhindo able to steer that one into the near corner. Sullivan collides with Link as they fight for the puck. Bottomley able to get it back to Turgeon. His shot goes off the stick of Johnson into the far corner. Gibbs will get it there, plays it ahead for Hodder. Hodder able to find Alain coming out of the zone. Alain has that puck get a little bit too far in front of him, and Turgeon able to turn it up the other way. Now here comes MJ Bottomley. Bottomley can't get a shot away as Gibbs gets his stick in the lane. Bottomley makes the pass. Sullivan couldn't get his stick on it. It ends up going to Turgeon. And if the name Bottomley is familiar to you and you're a junior hockey fan, yes, he is the grandson of Jim Bottomley, longtime coach in the Maritime Hockey League, now owner of the Liverpool Privateers of the Nova Scotia Junior Hockey League. Bottomley coached for just about every team in the MHL, it seems like, at one point or another. Puck comes to the line, Truen. He sends it towards the net. Henry turns it back the other way. McQueen getting it down the ice, but Bent gets it over to Truen. He'll get it ahead for Benigno. Here comes Benigno coming in. Benigno with a shot, and Sorhindo again, another nice save. Now Brocklehurst will pick up the puck out of the corner. And here comes Brocklehurst of the Bandits. He ends up losing control of the puck as he tried to make a stick handle there. Now it's Benigno in across the Bedford line, trying to feather it through for Lovett, but that's broken up by Breen. He gets it to McQueen, who will set it up for Normore, ahead to Brocklehurst. Brocklehurst, nice little play there, but Truen able to knock the puck away. McQueen gets it. He'll play it over to Brocklehurst near side. Brocklehurst can't get by Truen that time. And Benigno gets it ahead for Shearer. Shearer coming in on a partial breakaway. Shoots and scores! Will Shearer ties up the game with 12:43 to go. For Shearer, that's his second point this evening. Overall, it's his second goal and third point of the tournament. As we're all tied up with 12:43 remaining here in this third period. Charlie Benigno gets his second point of the night as well. Now there's a shot, and Sorhindo makes a save, and then after the whistle, we get a collision that sends Branton into the end boards with quite a bang. And Branton not too happy with it, but his team will get a power play out of it as a boarding call goes against Gibbs. So the Bandits will be shorthanded for the second time in this game. No, I thought the referee went over and signaled boarding. Yes, he did. Yeah, he's telling Gibbs, get over to the penalty box, and now Gibbs is going. I saw the referee head over there and signal boarding. So with 12:30 to go here in the third, we have the second Wolverine power play of the night. Bent with the puck. He'll play it over to Truen. Truen gets it back to the line for Bent. His shot. Sorhindo the save. And he will hang on for a faceoff. Just 13 seconds coming off of the penalty clock. 12:17 left to go here in period number three. And again, it's worth mentioning that if the score stays 2-2, or if it ends up being tied at a different number when the clock hits zero for the third period, there is no overtime. A tie remains a tie if you get there after 50 minutes. Cruin gets the puck to Uzuchukwu. He has it knocked off his stick. So the Wolverines have to try and get the puck back into the zone again. This time, Branton carries it in. He takes a bump from Link. Takes another bump from Link. Uzuchukwu will get the puck, play it back to the line for Bent. Bent's pass across to Truin at the near wall. Truin skates it up. Now comes back down into the corner for Proctor. Proctor goes back to the line for Bent, across for Uzuchukwu. Uzuchukwu with a shot. Sorhindo steers that one aside. Now it's played into the near corner, and it'll be picked up by Branton. Max Branton steps in, gets a shot away, save, rebound! And how does that one stay out? Did it go off the post or did it go off of the stick of Sorhindo? Either way, a glorious opportunity for the Wolverines. Somehow turned aside. Now Proctor with a chance, but Link gets his stick into the shooting lane. And the puck is cleared down the ice. 27 seconds left to go in the man advantage for the Wolverines. Under 11 minutes left in the third period. Bent out from behind his net. Plays it to Sullivan. That pass a little bit too far ahead of him. Breen will send it back down. It hops past the stick of Bent. And Benodio sets it up for his defenseman. Bent takes it behind the net now. Just 4 seconds left in the man advantage. We are about to be back to 5-on-5. And as Elaine gets the puck, that should not have been a hand pass. Elaine is the one who caught it and then was the next player to play it. And I think that's what Elaine is trying to argue. And our officials, hey, they're human beings. They make mistakes. And that was a mistake that time, unfortunately, by our referee, as Elaine gloved the puck ahead to himself, and he was the next player to touch it again. Puck comes back to Normore. He'll get it in across the line. Simonson will play it over for Turgeon. He gets it ahead. Now here comes Shearer to pick up the puck. Gets it over to Benigno. Benigno trying to set it up for Lovett, but a little bit too deep by that point, and Sorhindo able to gather it in and make the save. 10-10 left to go. Third period. 2-2 the score between the Bedford Bandits and the Halifax Wolverines. Bandits trying to avoid an 0-4 tournament. Wolverines looking to improve on their 1-1 record after their first two games. They'll play their fourth game of the event tomorrow. Puck goes behind the net. Elaine gets to it there. To the line. Simonson will play it back down low. Henry now gets it up to Hodder. Hodder will set it up to Elaine. Ahead for Johnson. Johnson can't get through Turgeon, and Lovett picks up the puck, plays it around the wall. Shearer able to pick it up there, working his way up the left wing. Shearer still with it. Tried to get it across for Benigno. That broken up by McGilvery. And now McGilvery able to get it ahead to Elaine. Elaine gets tripped up, and we will have a penalty against the Wolverines. Hodder coming in, though. Big save made there by Benodio. And the tripping call against Halifax with 9:29 to go in the third period. And it is Turgeon who will go off for that trip. So the Bedford Bandits, who are 1-for-2 in the power play in this game, get a chance to possibly try and reclaim the lead here with the power play. But it's a good start to the kill for the Wolverines as Bent gets the puck down the length of the ice. Set there by Sorhindo for Breen, and Breen will work his way ahead over for Gibbs. Gibbs has that puck get a little bit too far away from him, and Bent gets it back out to center. Elaine now waits for everybody to get onside, then dumps the puck in, goes around the boards, race for it. Breen gets there just ahead of Bent and sends it back behind the net. McQueen going after it there. He'll play it up the wall. Now it's back to the line for Gibbs. He gets it across the far side for Breen. Breen plays it to McQueen. McQueen down into the corner for Alain. Back to McQueen again. Stepping in to the middle of the ice. Now backing up towards the line. He'll take the puck across the near side. Gets it over for Breen. Breen with a shot. And that's blocked in front by Bent. And Bent able to get it down the ice. 1 minute gone in the man advantage. Sorhindo will set the puck there for Gibbs. Gibbs back to pick up. He'll take it behind the net and work his way up the middle of the ice. Gibbs cutting over to the right wing. Takes a hit from Bent as he gets the puck down into the corner. Sullivan able to get to it. And he'll clear it away with 38 seconds left to go in the power play. Gibbs back again to pick up. He'll take it behind the net once again. This time he'll go for a long lead pass, but that misses his intended target of McQueen. It went close enough to Truen for there not to be an icing, and now the puck is launched down the other way, and of course that wouldn't have been an icing anyway because the Wolverines are on the penalty kill, but it ended up going right on target onto Sorhindo. Now this time Brocklehurst will carry the puck ahead. Comes to the right wing side, or left wing side, has the puck knocked away from him by Truen, and Truen able to launch it down the ice as the penalty comes to an end. We're back to 5-on-5, down under 7.5 minutes left to go in the third period. Tie hockey game. Here's McLean with the puck. He'll fire it around the boards. It'll come to the near side. Takes a bounce off the Zamboni door that ends up sending it back behind the net again. And there again, you see some of the weird bounces that you get here from time to time. Wolverine's able to get the puck out to center ice. Link ends up putting it off the skate of Benigno. Now Shearer comes in, and just getting a piece of it with his blocker was Sorhindo. Now Link will play it up the near wall for Kidd. Kidd gets it to the line. Turgeon playing soccer to get it back down to where Kidd is. Link pokes it up ahead for McLean. McLean out across the red line. He'll bring it up to the Halifax blue line and then send it deep to the end board. Simonson wraps it around the wall. It'll come all the way up to Shearer out in neutral ice. Shearer trying to get away from Conlon. Love it over there to help out as well, and dumps the puck in deep. Picked up by Breen. Breen loses it to Benigno. Benigno tries to get it in front of the net, but able to help clear that away from danger was Conlon. Now Benigno gets it back. Pass for Branton. That gets deflected on its way to him, and it ends up in his feet. And the Bedford Bandits are able to force the turnover, and Kidd will send it down the length of the ice. Under 6 minutes left to go here in the third period. Tie game. O'Leary with it for the Bandits. He'll try to get it back down towards the corner. Branton intercepts that. Lead pass for Proctor. Proctor coming in with Uzuchukwu. Puck knocked off Proctor's stick by Breen. Proctor able to win it back, though. Now he'll send it towards the net. Uzuchukwu has it go off the skate. Plays it back to the line for Bent. His shot goes off of Uzuchukwu, who seems to be favoring his ankle after that puck hit him. Now Proctor back to the line for Bent again. Over to Girard near side. Girard with the shot. Breen steers that one into the end boards. Now Breen will get it from behind his own net. Takes it right to the front. And then was able to feed it to Normore, who got it ahead for O'Leary to Hodder back. Or Hodder still with it. Now gives to Conlon. Conlon with a shot. That goes off the leg of Girard, excuse me. And it ends up going over the glass and out of play. And we'll get a stoppage with 5:03 remaining here in the third period. 2-2 Wolverines and Bandits. If this game does end in a tie, that will mathematically eliminate both the Bedford Bandits and the Novas from contention to get into a playoff spot, as the maximum that the Novas would be able to get would be 2 points, and the Wolverines would be in fourth place with 3 points if this game ends in a tie. Again, if the Bandits are able to get a victory here, they will still be alive. A tie will not help the Bandits. A win, they would still need some help from other results. but they'd at least be in contention to possibly get into a situation for a tiebreaker. And so it'll be interesting to see as we get down to the closing moments here whether the Bandits pull their goalie for an extra attacker if the game is tied with a minute or so left. Henry looking to go cross ice with that pass. It ends up going to Elaine. Now Bottomley gets the puck. He goes to play it ahead. It's kicked away by McGilvery and now sent in to the Halifax zone. Bottomley there to gather it in. Bottomley will play it across to Bent, who I think has played about 17 of, or about 15 of the 16 and a half minutes we've played in this third period so far. Seems like every time I turn around, he's there on the ice, although not that I've been turning around because I've been sitting here facing the ice the whole time. You know what I mean. McQueen gets the puck knocked off his stick right at the blue line. So a delayed offside. That gives Bent a chance to get the puck out. He'll get it as far as the Halifax blue line. Now we'll get the Bedford blue line. Excuse me. Now we'll get an offside against the Wolverines. 3:20 left to go here in the third period. Face-off will be on the right-wing side as the Bandits look at it. Left-wing side from the Halifax perspective. And we're going to get another offside call against Halifax here. 3:15 left to go now here in the third. So the Novas, I'm sure, watching with interest, hoping that the Bandits can help keep the Novas' chance alive as well. A win by the Wolverines or the game ending in a tie, either one of those results would eliminate both the Bedford Bandits and the Novas. That much I can tell you for sure. The only thing that will keep both the Novas and the Bandits alive is if the Bandits get the victory in the next 3 minutes and 9 seconds. With the puck, here's Gibbs. He'll lead the rush himself. In across the blue line, cutting to the outside. Tries to get it to the front of the net. That's broken up by Bent. He'll feed it to Lovett. Lovett in across the line. Fires a shot. That goes just up over the crossbar into the end glass. Now picking up the puck is McQueen. He'll work his way up, trying to get through Truen. Truen able to force the turnover there. Puck gets to the line and out. McLean has to wait for everybody to get onside. He'll dump the puck in. Bandits will make a change here with 2.5 left to go in the third period. Bent plays it ahead to Shearer. Shearer brings it across the blue line. Gets around one player, couldn't get around the second. Puck goes into the corner. Lovett tried to get it back to Shearer, but now it's turned over. Here come the Bandits. Here's a chance for Kidd. Kidd coming in, working down, gets the shot away, looking far post, and ends up just missing the net with that one. Great chance there for Nathan Kidd, but couldn't quite get it on target. Now Kidd with another shot, and that ends up getting blocked by Truen as Truen was falling down. I think it might have caught him high in the chest or maybe even up towards the neck, and Truen in some discomfort as he makes his way to the Halifax bench. And Logan Truen laying his body on the line here to try and keep his team in this tie score. And with 1:50 left to go in the third period, we are still tied, and we'll start to keep an eye on Sorhindo to see if he does come out of the net. Again, a tie will not be enough for the Bandits. They need to get a victory to keep their chances alive. Puck comes down all the way deep into the Bedford. McGilvery tying up along the end boards against Branton. Proctor in there as well. Now the puck has worked free to Elaine. He tries to get a pass away. Now Proctor with a shot, save, rebound! And Branton with the second chance shot ended up putting that just wide of the net. 80 seconds left to go in regulation. Puck came out to center and then got dumped back in. And so we'll get an offside call against the Wolverines. 1:15 left to go in the third period. drops off at the far dot, just outside the Bedford blue line. And the Wolverines will use their timeout here with 1:15 left to go in the third period. And while the Wolverines are on their timeout, we'll let you know once again that the sponsor for this game is Basin Contracting Limited, and they will be sponsoring the players of the game coming up right after the conclusion. We also have some tournament sponsors, the gold level sponsor, Coltec Windows and Entrance Systems, silver level sponsors, Andy's Tire Shop Limited, SBM Offshore, and Maritime Trust Limited, and the bronze level sponsors, Motor Hub Automotive Group, Stanfields Limited, Dairy Queen, and Virtual McDougall. So let's reset here with a minute 15 on the clock. The score tied 2-2. Wolverines have Truin, Bent, Shearer, Lovett, and Benigno. The Bandits have Brocklehurst, McQueen, Alain, Gibb, and Link out there. And Link is the one with the puck right now. He'll play it over to Gibb. Gibb gets it off the wall as far as the center ice line. Truin goes to dump it back in. Now Gibb with it to McQueen. McQueen will get it down the ice, and that will be not be an icing as Bent goes back to get it. Sorhindo not making a move. Now the puck gets out to center ice. Brocklehurst has to wait for Alain to get onside. Brocklehurst will play it to the near side. Now Gibb and Sorhindo not even looking towards the bench, so I don't think they realize that they would still be alive if they win the game, but a tie wouldn't work. Now coming the other way, here's Shearer coming in. Shearer with a chance, and Sorhindo able to make the save. 27 seconds left to go in the third period. Lovett gets it back to the line for Bent. Bent plays it down to Shearer. Shearer looking to get it to the front of the net. It's knocked off his stick. Truin will pick up, get it back down to Shearer. It goes beyond him, though, all the way around to Benigno at the far wall. Gibbs clears that away from the front of the net. Benigno loses the puck to Alain. 6 seconds left. Benigno able to steal it back. Benigno gets it down. There's a shot, a save by Sorhindo. As a whole bunch of players end up in the crease. Players diving everywhere. And with 1 second on the clock, we'll get a face-off in the Bedford zone. So the Bandits will not point and not finish off with a record of 0-4. Shearer taking the draw against Brocklehurst. Shearer tries to get the puck to the net. He doesn't. And the final score will be Bandits 2, Wolverines 2. That score line will mathematically eliminate the Bandits from contention to get to a semifinal. It will also eliminate the Novas, as even if the Novas win tomorrow, their best record, the best they can finish is 1-3, and the Wolverines in fourth place right now are at 1-1-1. So the Halifax Wolverines are able to eliminate two teams from playoff contention here tonight. We'll get you the players of the game here right away, and so many players you could talk about who had a great game tonight. For the Bedford Bandits, how about that third period as we await the announcement of those players of the game. For Halifax, there were Will Shearer, Charlie Benigno, each with a goal and an assist.
Is number 33.
And Dylan Benozio, who stopped 23 of 25 shots for the tie. Certainly deserving. And why not Jared Sorhindo? Both goaltenders between them stopped 60 of 64 shots. So those are two very deserving young men for the players of the game for each team. That's going to wrap things up for day number two here at the 2023 Goaltech Nova Scotia Under 15 Major Hockey Championship Tournament. As the teams shake hands on behalf of my awesome cameraman, Duncan, this is Michael Petter saying, may your skates always be sharp, may your shots always hit the top shelf. Final score once again ends in a tie between the Halifax Wolverines and the Bedford Bandits, 2-2, the final score. Thanks so much for watching. Enjoy the rest of your Friday night. We'll be back with you tomorrow at 8 a.m. Which will show up way too soon.
So you have to end the event to let me do that.